Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. Our next panel is on the next generation relationships. Should we be offering hybrid, personal, or digital client advice to this audience? To answer this question, I'm delighted to introduce three illustrious speakers from the wealth management world. David Montgomery is managing director of M&G Wealth. Have I demoted you, or are you CEO there, David?
I'm the managing director. Yep, you've got that spot on.
Managing director. Sorry about that. Managing director of M&G Wealth, based in Edinburgh, and it's great to have you with us again, David.
Thanks, Yuri.
And Mariam Rassai is head of client experience, very much responsible for the digital transformation at BNP Paribas Wealth Management. Welcome back, Mariam.
Hello, Yuri. Thank you.
And Gareth Johnson is head of digital channels at Brewin Dolphin. Good to meet again, Gareth, although sadly it's another digital encounter.
Hi, Yuri. How are you, everyone?
So I'll put a few questions to our panelists, ladies and gentlemen, but please feel free to contribute your own comments and questions in the box on the right-hand side of the screen to keep our participants on their toes. So if I can start with Gareth at Brewin Dolphin. At the beginning of the digital revolutions, many banks seem to have this build it and they will come mentality, that you'd have a substantial digital spend, you'd announce it to the market, and you'd suddenly get a load of clients. Do you think that philosophy has changed somewhat?
It's definitely changed somewhat. And I think that's because, you know, consumers these days are a bit more wise to the content that's being created. I came across this concept earlier in a week called continual partial attention, this kind of connected, always on, anytime, any place mindset that we're all in, you know, this constantly distracted by the ping of the phone, the Teams channel, the Slack channel or whatever. And I think what that's done is really made people value their time and their attention a little bit more. They want to be a bit more focused. They want to be a little bit less distracted. And I think the idea now is that people want to almost, you know, go and see, or consumers want to see something that's going to make a difference to their life. And it's not just who has the biggest market and budget. And indeed, we've seen some very good propositions, some very good people, some very good ideas with good quality market and budget fall away and close. And I think that's ultimately because they didn't address what the customer was trying to do. They didn't solve a problem for the customer. I think a lot of customers are getting wise to that. That doesn't mean for the marketeers out there, there is not value in marketing, but I think we've got to be much more specific about what we're doing. It isn't just plastering the tube with adverts. It isn't just, you know, using the cookie trail on the internet to follow you around and constantly promote. I think we've got to be a lot wiser in what we're doing and really focus on solving a problem for the client. And I think that value trade-off comes. You've made a difference for me. You've changed something for me. You've solved the problem I had, rather than it was a glitzy marketing campaign that might have had an influencer, that might have been on social media, that might have been in physical media. So yes, I definitely think there's been a change. And I think marketeers, proposition owners are really thinking more deeply about how do we solve that problem for the customer.
And we hear a lot of talk, Gareth, about the hybrid model. Are clients now ready for the digital-only services?
So to bring this to life, I think of a client, an ultra high net worth client born in 1955, right? This person travels quite a bit these days, would be most firms' biggest and perhaps most important client. Do they want digital only? And do we want to give them digital only? Now, if I then tell you the person I'm thinking of is Bill Gates, does that change your answer? So as I took you through that and put that digital, now you know it's Bill Gates I'm thinking of, does that change your answer? And the answer should be, it shouldn't have changed your mind. It shouldn't have changed how you thought about that. Because I think we've got to look at this as a bit of a segment of one, right? Some are ready for digital, some aren't. Some will be, some never will be. And I think the key is don't assume. We have clients in their 60s who are much more comfortable with digital than those in their 40s. And you go, well, hold on, that doesn't work. That can't be true. Well, why is that? Well, some individuals who are retired have time. They have time to learn about these new services and spend time immersing themselves, dare I say, playing with things, where the person in their 40s might be time pressed. They've got a family, they've got a career, they've got personal lives. The flip side of that, and again, I've tried to guide the witness to go, hey, there's a trade-off there. Flip side of that, in my 40s, I might be the most busy I need and I only need digital services. So I think the key is don't assume. We've got to remember that wealth is really important and actually use digital to win in the moments that matter. That doesn't mean every moment, but it means allowing consumers to come to you, speak to you, have that human interaction when they need it, and digital where it fulfills, again, that job that they want doing, that need at that moment in time.
So it's all very well, and if I can bring in Gareth, talking about this mixed or this hybrid model where we have some digital access, some face-to-face advice, but the reality is, in the UK, there's a big shortage of advisors. I think you've called it the advice gap in the past. There's a lot of families that need personal advice, but they simply can't get it. I mean, too many advisors have left the business, and now we have this great resignation on top of this during COVID. Is this one of the main reasons so many firms are investing in digital facilities, because there aren't enough advisors to go around?
Yeah, I think that one's for me, Yuri, right?
Absolutely. Absolutely. For you, David. Yes.
Yep. I mean, I think this is, I mean, Gareth's right, is how customers want to interact with us. That's the first and foremost, right? So there's a digital option. There's certainly the more traditional face-to-face advice. But I think if you look at what hybrid's trying to do, it's trying to solve that problem. It's trying to blend technology solutions with physical advice, because physical advice is still valued. There's a lot of trust that's placed in the relationships that clients can have with an advisor. And it's really about trying to make that process more efficient. And as a result, you know, going back to that comment I make about the advice gap, it's providing more advice to, or creating the ability to provide more advice to more people. So is there an advice gap in the UK market? Yes. I think there's people that need advice who can't get it, or people who could benefit from advice and can't get it. And is that related to the number of advisors? Probably. You know, as an industry, I think we need to bring more advisors into the market so that we can provide more advice. But it's certainly about our advice processes. It's about the ability to become more efficient, be able to provide more advice to more people, and help bridge that gap. And hybrid is certainly something that, as an industry, can see that we're all trying to work out what the best way to get that mix of technology and that physical advice in play in the market.
But we've got a very competitive jobs market at the moment, David, and being a financial advisor isn't necessarily the most popular route for a lot of young people, a lot of millennials. They might see financial advisors, bankers, as people they can't trust, who push some fancy products on people who don't really need them, and they trust that digital channel a lot more. How do you persuade them that being an advisor or a relationship manager can be quite an honourable way to make a living?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think I was reflecting on this. Advice is still something that's sold and not bought, if you like, right? People don't necessarily wake up thinking that they need advice and go out and search for it. So there is a bit of the selling aspect of it, like you're saying. But, you know, you just need to look at what's going on in society at the moment. There's a lot of focus on well-being. And financial security and money matters are a significant driver of stress and well-being issues. So as an industry, I think we need to talk about all the great things that we do to help people when they need it. And certainly advice is one of those aspects. It's not just talking about the products we sell. It's really about trying to talk and build that narrative about how we really help people when they need it. So from those aspects, I think it is a profession that the next generation or younger generation should be interested in for those reasons, if we think about well-being as being so important. And it just, you know, bringing it back to M&G, our purpose is to help people manage and grow their savings so that they can live the life they want. And when you talk about that purpose, it's a real honourable purpose. And if we're all sort of working in that space of helping people, looking after their money, giving them it back when they need it the most, then those are, I do think it's an honourable profession. We just need to talk about it as an industry in that way, how we help people. It's not necessarily about, you know, just being in that profession to make money. So I do think we've got more to do there, Yuri. But yeah, it's definitely an honourable profession that we should be promoting and bringing that next wave of advisors into the market for sure.
And Mariam, I know that you're very honourable, and one of the big initiatives you brought in BNP Paribas was your internal university and a certification for relationship managers. When advisors look for a bank to work for, a wealth manager to work for, bearing in mind the competitive nature of the industry, is this something they compare, the training, the university, the certification offered by different wealth managers?
Yes, absolutely. We started, in fact, back already. We have been a forerunner for the training of our RMs, and we put in place our certified private banker program 10 years ago. So we were really a front runner on this area, and our certification program, it covers a wide range of courses, and it's also, you know, those courses, they are delivered by our internal and external experts, and the program is then evaluated by written exam and also by an oral presentation in front of a jury. And today I have the privilege to be part of our certification jury for private bankers in France. And this training path, this very comprehensive training path, it is regularly updated. Digital is now part of it. And the whole process and the content, everything was accredited by a third party, the European Financial Planning Association, which assesses the quality of our internal education process. So this is, as I think you pointed out, this is very positively perceived by our staff. We receive very positive feedback from them on this Wealth Management University program that we put in place. And of course, it's also a way to ensure we deliver the best service to our clients.
Because Mariam, it's not just digital change which you've initiated at BNP Paribas Wealth Management. It's very much cultural change which goes hand in hand with this digital transformation. And what sort of challenges have you faced in changing the culture? Bearing in mind, you're something of a disruptor. You came into a bank which was dominated by very much white males, a Franco-French bank, very traditional. What sort of challenges did you face in transforming that culture into a more innovative, inclusive one?
In fact, digital transformation, as you mentioned, Yuri, it's really about a change in the culture. It's not only about bringing new technology to our clients and to our internal teams. We have to do that, of course. But digital transformation, it's also about creating new roles in the organization and developing new skills among our internal teams and deploying new ways of working. So the main challenge there is really to ensure that this transformation, it goes beyond the happy few, beyond the digital teams, and it really embraces to a large extent many of our teams, because this is the only way you ensure that there is a continuous pipe of innovation and that you continuously can generate new ideas and a lot of energy also in the organization. It's in fact the only sustainable innovation process and transformation is necessarily relying, you know, on a lot of our teams. So this is, I would say, the way we envision it, and we are doing it with a core team that includes many female talents from many geographies as well.
And the lockdown, the pandemic, has clearly been a crucial point in transforming the industry and its digitalization. And if I can bring in Gareth at Brewin Dolphin, we hear many digital leaders such as yourself were working on what we call lockdown projects to enhance their offer. Was the lockdown for you very much a hiatus when you could pause and reflect, where you could play the role of those creative midfielders that we love so much, the Glenn Hoddle who just puts his foot on the ball, looks around and plays that 30-yard pass with the vision? Was the lockdown that kind of opportunity for you to reassess what's going on around you?
Yeah, I think it was. And I think that, foot on the ball moment is a good analogy for us all to think about in that space. It wasn't necessarily pause and reflection. That sounds like we had a nice little relax during that time period. I'm sure every leader and every individual during that time period probably looks back and thinks it was one of the most intense periods of their career. But if we think of that as, you know, it was a war on the disease, and that gives you a little bit of a wartime mentality, what that allows you to do is kind of rip up the rule book a little bit. And I think it allowed us to do things at pace. I think it allowed us to rethink things, you know, those things that structural inertia. We've done things because we've always done it that way. I think it allowed us to really think about those elements. Dare I say it, there was, times more availability. You know, senior leaders weren't, decision makers weren't traveling, weren't in different areas. It was sometimes a bit easier to catch up with people. So there was, and I always hesitate saying this, there was many benefits to the pandemic. That sounds as if I'm dismissing the health crisis. Of course I'm not. But I think there was a lot of things that just reframed in those minds, and then it allowed us to focus at some of the pain points. And as we did that, and as you know, those mentalities came together, that mindset came together, that energy and enthusiasm to solve real problems within our business, I think it unlocked the potential, and especially in digital, because of course we were all robbed of that physical interaction. So I think it allowed us to go and do a lot more in that space. And I think as well, if we think of our customers, you know, the clients that we all serve, we perhaps had perceptions, going back to the point I made earlier, perceptions of what they wouldn't want. And even some of those were ripped up. So it did allow us to solve problems in a slightly different way. It allowed us to work on different things. And I think the key, and it hangs on the back of what Mariam's just said, it's about that constant change culture, building that culture of constant change, innovation, moving stuff forward. We don't want it to be only when a pandemic hits do we innovate at pace.
And those pain points which you vividly refer to, Gareth, one of those has to be the onboarding, because for many wealth managers, it's taken weeks. It's supposed to be a time when the client really gets to know the relationship manager, when the relationship is cemented. And I spoke to one technology provider recently, and he said to me, for many banks, it's supposed to be a magic moment, but it ends up as a tragic moment. Do you think we've seen a whole scale change in the way that onboarding is conducted?
Yes, I think that's true. And I think everyone's tried to make it a bit more magic and a bit less tragic. I think that's a good way of putting it. And everyone, again, was focused on those. Again, what the pandemic did is perhaps highlighted where paper existed in processes, and paper can be very inefficient. It might need to go through the post, it might need to go through different areas. So it allowed us to rethink those business processes. And with the clients now at the heart of, you know, everything that we do, it allowed us to really, again, move forward with that. I think the phrase that sometimes comes is, who could have thought of doing it this way? Well, actually, we all could. You know, nothing I think that happened in the last couple of years was truly, you know, innovative. I don't think anything was, you know, out of this world. It was just deploying things that perhaps we'd previously dismissed, and deploying things that perhaps we thought our clients wouldn't want, wouldn't need, wouldn't engage with. And actually, we found perhaps a slightly different reaction to that across all sorts of different demographics and for all sorts of different things. We talked trust earlier. So again, how do you build that trust when we also know you've got cybersecurity challenges, and that was rife during a pandemic as well. So you've got to balance all of those things in the mind of the consumer. But definitely, we've certainly seen a great improvement over the last two years, and our clients benefit from that. The relationship managers benefit from that. Digital services benefit from that. And to the central point you were talking to David about earlier, you know, we have a really important role, you know, trying to help clients and customers manage their wealth over a much longer time period, and a time when private companies in the state are putting, you know, your retirement provision onto you. So being able to create that magic moment to, you know, entice them earlier in their lives is hugely important, not just for this moment and this financial year or this business unit, but for the future of the UK as well. So I really do think it is that big, attracting more people, making it, removing friction from the process and get more people into this really important industry.
So I'm getting a few questions coming in, and I'd like to build on those comments from Gareth about the onboarding. And Gareth, if I can put this question to you, because I think this is an advisor from your part of the world in the Northeast, and the advisor is asking, how much digital change do you see in the space of generating leads and identifying new clients?
And just to be clear, I can't answer questions from advisors around the country. I'm not, you know, only going to answer the ones from the Northeast. but I think the key thing of this is it's change, right? Yes, there's a lot of digital change. I think about how we go out there, how we attract customers, how we go into that space. I think there is change. I think there's also value of the traditional methods. You know, I see a lot of clients come from traditional networking spaces, you know, going to that roundtable event, going to that in the Northeast, there's a brilliant forum called the Entrepreneurs Forum. It's a wonderful place to go and meet like-minded individuals over a coffee and have that conversation and chat to people. There's some really great organizations, and we should support those. We should go and have those teas, those coffees, those drinks, those nibbles with those individuals. And I think in the digital space, it's also looking at where do consumers go for help and advice, and how do we get into those areas, not necessarily thinking it's just about ramping up the digital budget kind of thing, because I think that can be the mistake. It goes back to the build it and they will come. Spend a whole load of money, expect a whole load of clients. Not sure that's quite true. So we've got to be a bit smarter to try and attract those clients who are perhaps challenged with all of the digital interaction that they get these days. How do we cut through that noise?
And I've got another question, thank you, Gareth, which is a question which has come in for David. And this wealth manager is asking us, in the old world, advisors controlled access to information and platforms. All of that was controlled by the advisor. How do advisors stay relevant when people can now find out about and access investments directly themselves, generally at a much lower cost?
I think that's a really interesting question. And actually, I believe that the advisors still hold a lot of the access to that. You know, if you look at the size of our market, the advisory or intermediary market is still the largest part of the market. Now, I think what we're seeing is that people are starting to interact more directly. And there is this sort of rise of sort of more do-it-yourself type investing. And actually, we saw a lot of that happen during the pandemic, whether it was people had more time, strangely enough, or a little bit more disposable income. So we've certainly seen the rise in the sort of direct investing, going and getting an education and trying to do it yourself. But I think, you know, going back to a lot of the conversation we've had, when people, you know, think about the markets just now, when there's a bit more volatility in the market, when there's a bit more uncertainty, people tend to seek out advice. So I think there is, you know, advisors still hold a lot of the keys to that. They hold a lot of the access points to that. So, and I see that persisting for a long time to come yet. And I think it goes back to, we'll start to see balancing and shifting around that. But certainly to answer the question, I still see the advisor being a key to a lot of this, having a lot of the access points to the customer. And then it goes back to, I think, what we've been talking about here is, how do we as an industry help advisors with the technology and the processes to be able to provide that advice to more people? I think that's one of the key challenges that we have.
And I've got a wonderful question about this same topic, about the changing nature of advice that's coming from a private banker who wants to put this question to Mariam. And I'm delighted that this private banker has been inspired by this format we have here of the panel discussion, because they're asking, most advice is normally one-to-one, but isn't there a case for a client to be able to speak to a panel of advisors, a panel of private bankers, all of whom can each give them a slightly different opinion, perhaps in this kind of Zoom call format, and the panel could be chaired by the primary relationship manager? I mean, that sounds like quite an innovative format. What are your thoughts on that, Mariam?
Yes, in fact, that's, you know, in a way, that's pretty much the way we see things, because the way we, you know, advise our clients, it's not only the private banker, the relationship manager, it's a whole team, experts on many different topics, advisory, offering, wealth planning, credit. So the way we, you know, we want to accompany and help and advise our clients, it's not only a one-to-one relationship between the client and DRM. Of course, DRM has a very central role. He knows the client. There is usually a very long and trusted relationship. Our RMs and advisors, they are supported and surrounded by a lot of experts. And we do organize, of course, meetings where, you know, where the client can have access to the whole team of and the whole expertise, in fact, of.
And this, I mean, staying. Thank you very much, Mariana. I'm glad that this format is already in play. And this idea of new formats for the next generation, David. I speak to the next generation nearly every day in my kitchen, and my younger son, he's constantly on Reddit. And during the lockdown one day, he looked particularly down in the dumps. And I was saying to him, what's wrong? And I mean, he's 15 now. I think he was 13 at the time. And he said to me, we've got this battle on our hands with these nasty people called hedge funds. And they're trying to destroy one of our firms, he called it, one of our firms, GameStop. We need to fight back against these people. It seems many of the youngsters are looking for their investment advice and tips and knowledge, and they're looking for those on Reddit or TikTok. Should we convince them not to look to these channels, or should we learn from their relationship with these channels?
Yeah, I think there was actually an article just this week or last week around this very topic, Yuri, and it is, I do think there's a positive here where the next generation are looking, let's say they're looking for education or they're looking for advice. So that's a real positive. Where they're looking in the channel that they interact with. and that they understand. So I think as an industry, we need to learn how to interact in that channel if we are going to engage with the next generation. So I think the article that I read was around how do we use influencers in those channels? How do we sort of provide the sort of education, et cetera, and support to those influencers so that they are providing the right type of information to the next generation? So I think there's a ways to go on it, but it makes a lot of sense, right? Is if the next generation are looking for education, let's support them. They're looking in the channel that they know how to interact with. So we need to learn how to work in those channels and make sure the right information, the right support, et cetera, is filtering down through there. That's certainly the challenge that we have.
Thank you, David. If I can bring in Mariam about what the next generation is looking for from their investments. BNP Paribas has been one of the leaders in socially responsible investments, the ESG lens. Now that a country in the middle of Europe has been invaded by a neighbouring nation, obviously Ukraine invaded by Russia, how is this influencing the topics that your clients are engaging around with you, both digitally and physically?
Yes, we are living, of course, difficult times with many uncertainties, and this generates a lot of interrogations for our clients. And in this context, our mission, it's more than ever to be close to our client, to help them to prepare to preserve their wealth and to have a positive impact. And the war in Europe, it has two types of impact for us. One, which is a very direct and regulatory impact with the sanctions on the Russian companies that we have obviously to strictly comply with. And there is also an indirect impact with the significant increase of the oil and with questions around the energy independence. And this opens opportunities for the development of renewable energies, which is a transition that we want to accompany.
And thank you, Mariam. Is this a major concern for the Bruin Dolphin clients, Gareth?
Yeah, of course it is. I think we're all going to look at these and we're all going to think a bit more about sustainability, and we're all going to think about what does the future hold. You know, it's not the greatest idea to blow up the planet, shall we say. Well, you know, we don't want that for our kids, etc. I think the only thing I pick up from one of the things you just said about what do these younger clients, the next gen, want, we almost talk about that like it's a fixed state. They know what they want at 13, 15, 18, and that will continue for the next 30, 40 years. I guess part of it's trying to think a bit more about that change that we all go through. If we all think of ourselves at, you know, 18 and where we all are now, and that change you naturally go through. That's not to say someone would want sustainable investments now and wouldn't in 10 years' time, but I think it's about how do we get comfortable, I guess comfortable being uncomfortable, that you don't know everything that's going to happen and it's going to change. But if you become a bit more responsible, if you think a bit more, if you can demonstrate that you're trying to do the right things for the planet and the future, that sounds like a good thing, you know, people can buy into. We think of Tesla and the electric car revolution, and that sounds like a really simple play. But if you then go and look at the how they get cobalt from West Africa, and if that's child labour, is that still the same on the ES and the G score? Question. And I'm not clever enough to know all of those answers, but I think there's a lot of information out there. We've got to think about the state, and we've got to constantly go and try and do the right thing on a daily, weekly, monthly basis. And I think the companies who do that will be rewarded over the long term.
I agree with what Gareth is saying. There's a lot of assumptions being made. And David, there's almost a certain arrogance amongst the bigger banks and financial firms that they know all the answers when it comes to anticipating trends and leading digital transformation. Do we need to see perhaps a greater humility with the major players working with smaller startups and taking inspiration for progress from different sectors in the economy and society?
Absolutely, Yuri. I mean, I think there's an arrogance is the right word, probably. I mean, there's also this kind of view that the bigger banks, providers, whatever you want to call it, can build it better. And that tends to be what happens, right? Is they try and build it themselves or build it ourselves because we think we can do it better. And I think we do have to be open to this kind of build it if you can, buy it if somebody else is doing it, or partner with people who are already doing it in the market. So I think there's been open to that. And then definitely this kind of looking at what startups are doing, look at what other sectors are doing. Normally the problems that we're trying to solve for are already being solved somewhere else. Now we might need to change the approach to make it fit with financial services. I think there's always this view that, you know, big institutions and financial services are complex. What startups are doing or other sectors won't apply or can't quite fit. I think we need to challenge that mindset, and we need to always look to see what others are doing and whether we can apply it and find ways of making that work. So yeah, I do see the shift happening. I do see that, you know, the fintech, world is moving on. There are lots of startups there, and a lot of startups that are starting to partner with the big providers and big banks, etc. So I think we need to do more of that. Absolutely.
So this entrenched mindset, which David is talking about, Mariam, this is a traditional banker's mindset, and you come yourself from an engineering background. Do we really need the data scientists, the engineers, the fintech guys to be running the banks and wealth managers rather than the traditional bankers?
In fact, you raise the question of the place of technology in wealth management, I think. And technology, it has been an enabler, a very important enabler for years, for banks, for managers. And it is true that now it's becoming a bit different because it's becoming a very important lever to really design the future of the industry. Because I think all of us, the way we envision the future of wealth management, it's very much linked to developing digital products and using AI and leveraging on data. So of course, technology, in a way we are all becoming also tech companies. But having said that, what our clients are expecting from us, it's really very eager to have the human interaction, the trusted relation with their RM that they know for a long time. So I think we really need to leverage on both our skills, and both our bankers and our engineers and data science to design and to deliver the optimal service to our client.
So on that data side, I've got a question that's just come in for you, Mariam, about the customer experience and the 360 degree view of the client. How will that change now that it's very much driven by data science?
So I think there is the question of the 360 view for our internal staff. That's one aspect of the question. The fact of equipping our RMs with the right tools so that they access centrally to all the client history, preferences, interactions, and that this helps our teams, and of course using also latest technologies, it helps us to be even more relevant in the service, in the content, in the advice that we provide to the client. But there is also the other aspect, which is providing to the client himself the 360 view of all his all his assets, all his liabilities, and the access also to information that comes from us, to our own view about what we think, our advice, but also sometimes also information that comes from the external world. And this is what we are doing, for example, by providing curated, selected content and press reviews coming from external point of view to our client.
Thank you very much, Mariam. And if I can bring in David here, because there's a question that's come in for you as well, exactly on this point about data. Will your wealth management platform be able to identify the next best action or the next best expert to speak to using artificial intelligence and data science?
Yeah. I mean, I think that's where we absolutely want to go to. So next best action is not something that's necessarily new. We've been talking about that in industry for a long time, isn't it? Gathering the information that the customer's telling us about themselves, and then us trying to point them to take the next action step. But certainly that sort of artificial intelligence or just the continual use of data to better inform what should happen next. I think that's the technology or business process challenge that we are constantly striving for. And I would say probably, you know, we're scratching the surface a little bit at that moment. We're probably applying the sort of technology and the sort of data to the processes that we have. I think what we're saying is we need to flip that round, is how do we use that data to understand what the processes are that the customer's really looking for? Those are the challenges. That's something we in M&G with our platform, with our technology, we're constantly looking to improve on.
And with the risk of sounding like Cilla Black in that great 80s and 90s program Blind Date, the same question to number three. Gareth, is that an aim of the development of your platform, to use the data and artificial intelligence to be able to identify the key expert to speak to or the next best action?
I think if you get this right, I keep saying this phrase, you win in the moment that matters. You know, we can all say we know our clients, yeah, and we can sit there and say, I've got two clients, I've got David and Gareth, and I know them really, really well. And the markets start falling down, and I assume they've got great composure. But David's checking his investment platform every 2 minutes, you know, really worried. Gareth's totally relaxed. We should have different responses to those. It goes back to a comment I made earlier, that segment of one. We should think about how we use that data to deliver information differently to David than we would Gareth. And then kind of just help the client in that moment. And I think that's a key thing, just help them without it being that. We've talked a little bit about arrogance, about we know what the next thing is. We won't know what the next thing might be for that client. Let's deploy that, build more data, and then try and help them. But also sometimes it's useful to build the algorithm. I always think about, or break the algorithm. I always think about this when listening to music. If you just let Apple curate it, you'll never hear the new things. You'll never hear the exciting things, but the data would suggest I only want to hear more of this.
So, Gareth, you've talked previously about a hype cycle for technologies. Do you feel there's sometimes too much of an obsession that a particular technology will transform the wealth management landscape?
Without doubt. I looked at this a little earlier. I went onto Google Trends and looked up robo-advice. You go to like 2017 peak of everyone looking for robo-advice. You look at where it is now, no one's kind of really talking about it. The hype cycle, for those who aren't familiar, that idea that there's a tech trigger, then we go straight up this peak of inflated expectations. When it doesn't reach those expectations, we come sliding down the trough of disillusionment. We get to a slope of enlightenment, and then we maybe get to a plateau of productivity. It happens in many areas, and we do this all the time. I was thinking of a real world example that's not technology, and I'm going to use the example of Emma Rajakarnu, right? She unpredictably won a major, right? She wasn't at major level, but our expectations for what she can now do are unbelievable. The scrutiny that she's now under. And of course, when she has to retire due to injury, you know, she's in a growing body, we suddenly start, you know, she's not good enough. She hasn't got the right mentality. And all of these things happen with technologies. It's going to save the world. Oh, it's actually not going to save the world. It's a waste of time. We've got to be much more measured in how we evaluate these technologies. We've got to move away from that instant gratification and think, how might that work over 3, 5, 10 years time? And then double down our efforts, rather than get too excited about robo-advice is going to get rid of all of the advisors in the UK, solve all of the advice problems, bring everyone to advice, and actually it did none of those things. And that's not me saying it's not a bad or it's a bad thing. It's a brilliant thing. It moved lots of people forward, but we've got to stop doing that. We've got to be much more calm and relaxed about these things and get a more smooth journey in that space.
Well, I think it's very interesting, Gareth, talking about where we are now and where we were, and I think any of us, whether it's me commenting about the industry, writing about the industry, or yourselves involved in the industry, could have imagined where we would be today compared to where we were in the 90s when you all started your careers. And if you could just briefly sum up for me in another 25, 30 years, how do you see what is the wildest part of your imagination? Where does it see the wealth management industry going? If I can start with Mariam.
Very difficult to imagine where we will be in 25 years, of course, when we see how you know different things are today compared to what we could have imagined. Let's put it this way. I just hope that we will have found the right balance between human technology. Keeping in mind also the collective impact that we have on the environment. I just hope that it's a balanced relation, that we have between human and digital, and all this is done without impacting too much the environment.
Thank you, Mariam. David?
Yeah, I'm probably going to echo the same points. I'm not sure. It's hard to, you know, over that period of time, Yuri, we've seen we're a relationship business. And although things have changed, regulations changed, technologies came along, we're still a relationship business. So I think we're a resilient sector, and I think the sector will kind of stay the same. But my hope would be that we do start to see this kind of blend of that kind of hybrid technology that we've spoken a lot about today, that we utilize that to still be a relationship-driven business, but we do it in a much more efficient way, and we get our services, we get that help out to more people in the market. So that's what I would look for in the years to come.
Thank you, David. And a final word to you, Gareth.
Well, I mean, I think we're all sitting as a panel going, Marianne, David, they were terribly boring answers. Let's go and look at some sci-fi movies. Let's go and see some crazy things out there. I think Star Trek and Minority Report and all of those things have predicted where we're going. Go and watch a sci-fi movie. We'll all be in the metaverse, sitting in a little pod, not having to interact with everyone, with VR headsets, getting all of the data pumped into our brain. And you know what? If I'm wrong, I'll be retired in 25 years for time, so you can't pick me up.
Well, you know, you spoke, Gareth spoke about this the inflated expectations and the trough of the of disillusionment. I hope that that was not a description to our, of our panel today. I definitely don't think it was. So many thanks to our erudite panelists. I hope you've enjoyed this as much as I have, and to you, ladies and gentlemen, for your participation. This panel will be available from tonight to view on playback for the next 30 days using the same link. So there's a special treat for you. Our next interview is by my colleague Elisa Trovato with the grand dame of private banking, Sally Kravchek. So that is one not to be missed, and it's live on air in a few minutes' time. So pour yourselves a cup of tea and prepare to keep the discussion going.